Hey, good morning, everyone. My name is Marcio. I'm one of the teaching pastors here. I'm really excited because guess what? It's this Christmas season, guys. Come on. We should be excited about the Christmas season because, you know what, we can talk about Jesus and we get all excited. You know, the holidays, the really random desserts that we get to have. Even the crazy family members are less crazy during the Christmas season. Like, things change during the Christmas season. And for the next 4 weeks, we're going to have this Christmas series called All I Want for Christmas Is. And this morning, we're going to talk about hope. And we're going to talk about hope in Jesus. And I hope, man, how did you feel about that worship? Can we let our worship team know how amazing that was? That was for real, my goodness. But I would be doing you a disservice if we don't start the Christmas series, All I Want for Christmas, with something that everybody knows, a little song that I need 100% participation in. So that requires clapping on beat and singing along. Can you guys promise that? Okay, thank you. I got like 35% yes. I need a little bit more, okay? Can you guys promise you're going to help me? Because I'm not singing this one. Now, I need you all to channel your inner Mariah Carey. Here we go. Come on. Sing with me. Come on now. You know it. Clap. Good, didn't it? Woo! Man, now you know she was talking about Jesus, right? Oh, she wasn't, right? But we're going to be talking about Jesus this morning. Thank you for participating. That was a lot of fun. And we're talking about hope. We're talking about hope and the hope that Jesus gives us. It's exciting. And here's the core idea for this morning, and we're not going to write it down. I mean, we're not going to have it on the screen, but I want you to write it down. And it's this, that hope gives life. Hope gives life. Okay, so here's what I want to do. I want you to think about your childhood. Think about a Christmas gift that you were like hoping to get and then you got. And I want you to shout it out. Someone tell me some of the Christmas gifts you hoped for as a kid and you got. Go ahead. Oh my gosh, that really didn't work the way I expected. I can't hear anything. Okay, I just want from this section, go. Christmas gift. Hey, go. Someone shout about a Christmas gift you got as a kid. Go. Easy bake oven. Nice. Wasn't that exciting? What about here? Quick. Baseball cap? Glove. Okay, baseball glove. Okay. What about here? Guitar. Okay. Guitar. What about here? Bike. Bike. I heard Lion Kugel. I'm like, what's that? I don't even think that exists. But bike. Okay, now, do you remember thinking about that gift and then how nice you were to your parents because you knew it? Everything hinged on that moment, right? Of the time when you asked for the gift and then waiting to open it up. There was this period where hope gave you life. It made you kinder. You were more grateful. You were a sweeter child before you got your easy bake oven, right? Like, you waited for it, and you were hoping, and then when you got it, man, you were like, yeah, it was exciting. Hope gives life. It changes you. It gives you more passion. It gives you joy. It gives you peace. I mean, think about it when you know a job promotion is coming or a raise is coming. You act a little bit different. You work a little bit harder. You're more excited about going to work. Think about when you're ready for vacation And you're hoping for vacation, you got it on the calendar, and you're waiting for it, and you just, every day comes, as you get closer, you get so excited for the day you get to spend with your family in this new place, in this new town, in this new environment. I mean, hope, it gives life. It really does. For some of you, do you remember the second date? Ooh, so excited, you're nervous. Is she gonna call back? Is he gonna call back? And then the third date happened, the fourth date happens, the fifth date happens, and you're thinking, man, I think we're gonna get married, and you're hoping for that to happen, and the hope gives you so much life. What do? You end up changing your wardrobe. You realize, I wanna look better for this person. Like, I wanna change things. You start working out and all this stuff. Hope gives you life. But hope can be dangerous too, can it? Because what happens with the human condition is that we take hope and we transfer it and we make it something it's not supposed to be. Because see, when you put your hope in Jesus, he's the one that transforms you. He's the one that changes you. He's the one that gives you life. He's the one that fills your soul with everything it needs to survive here on earth, and not just survive, but to thrive no matter what comes your way. And the danger is when we take our hope away from the most certain thing, the only 100% guarantee we have here on earth, and that's God's love for us and his promises, and we put it on something else or someone else. For some of you, you put your hope in your career, and then after 30 years or 20 years, however long, whenever your career is over, you don't know who you are, whether it's retirement or you got fired. You're left with nothing. Some of you put your hope in a person. You hope they would change. You hope something would be different, and then they abandoned you. They left you, and you're drained. Where's hope now? Some of you put all your hope in a medical something, a report, a doctor, or medicine, and health hasn't changed. And some of you hope that you would see a certain person for the holidays, and that isn't happening. Hope can be dangerous when we put it on the wrong things, and we treat hope, we treat something else, thinking that that thing or that person could fulfill us the way God can. That's dangerous. That's why the Apostle Paul writes this in Romans 15:13. He says this, Now may the God of hope, God of hope, underline that, because God created hope and he matched it perfectly for your soul to experience. Fill you, circle the word fill, draw an illustration of what full looks like, with joy and peace as you believe in what? As you believe in God, as you believe in his promises, as you believe in everything he tells you about you and about him. Because we're putting our hope in him and all his promises, so that you may overflow with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. And it's not just to fill you. We don't have just a God who fills us to meet expectation. No, our God overflows hope. He just explodes our expectations out of the water. He wants you to be filled with his hope. That no matter what goes on here, no matter what you deal with here, no matter what's trying to deplete your soul of life, there is hope in Jesus Christ, and he fills it up. He's there. He's aware of your situation. And here's the thing. God saw the condition of humanity, and he said, I got to come down. I got to give humanity hope. Because they're putting their hope, they're putting all of their soul's resources on things that aren't certain. On another person. On things like their career, their money. And when Jesus came down, he wants to remind us this, that we are the reason for the season. That we are the reason for the season. It's going to come up here in a second. Yeah. We are. We are here. We are alive. We have hope in Jesus Christ so that we could just pour our direction, our energies, our life, everything goes to him and gives him praise and him glory. And he saw our condition. He's like, you guys are hopeless without me. So he came down to give us hope. Not, and listen, he's not this like genie in the bottle, because I think some of us, we think that hope, see, when we put our hope in false things, we think like, oh my gosh, this person, once I get this person, if we get married, you know, this person's going to change everything about me, you complete me, that whole thing, and you would think things will change us completely or change our situation, and everything's going to look different from this point on. We treat things like a genie, hoping it's a fix immediately, and God's like, my hope isn't some genie kind of hope. My hope fills you with joy and peace and trust that I will direct your life. I am still writing your story, and I will have an outcome far greater than you could ever imagine. My outcome will give hope and love and direction and purpose and meaning and significance, not just to you who put your hope in me, but to those around you. And what we need to know about hope is this, that hope delivers us from fear. Hope delivers us from fear. Okay, so this guy named Luke, which you have in the New Testament, you have Matthew, Mark, Luke. Luke was a doctor, and he was friends with the disciples. And he wrote an account of Jesus' life, and he sent it to a friend of his named Theophilus. That's why we have this letter called Luke, the third gospel. So in Luke chapter 2, we have the Christmas story. So can we go there to that verse? Luke 2 verses 9 and 10, it says this. Then an angel of the Lord stood before them. Who's the them? Shepherds. There were just shepherds out in this field. And the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, hey, don't be afraid. Don't be afraid. Keep this up for a moment, please. Don't be afraid. Think about it. Imagine you're a shepherd. December 25th for you back in that day was just like any other day. You're just hanging out with your friend, Bill and Jim. Right? Hey, Bill, how you doing? Well, Jim, doing pretty good. Hey, Bill, what are you going to be doing tomorrow? Well, Jim, I'm going to do the same thing I did yesterday, same thing I did today. Watch sheep. That's it. Oh, really? Yeah. Hey, Bill, guess what, man? I'm going to get engaged. I haven't met her yet. It's kind of arranged, but things are going to happen in my life. Oh, really? And they're just talking, and out of nowhere, I think that's what happened. And then all of this light and all this noise, and then angels popped up. Like, what's going on? And they're freaking out. Just losing. Guys, if an angel came in here right now and just popped up right here, some of you would think, oh my gosh, all of us would freak out. But some of you, you know, that are trigger happy, you think it's an attack from Al-Qaeda, and you're going to start shooting at it. It's just an angel. It's like, stop, you killed the pastor. I'll see you soon. So keep it in there, cowboy, cowgirl. Okay? All I'm saying is that we would lose it if an angel came. And he told them, don't be afraid. Why? Because Jesus is coming. Hope is coming. Hope is coming. See, do you ever wonder why people live in fear? Why do we sing these songs, don't be afraid? You no longer have to be a slave to fear. It's because when we put our hope in something other than Jesus, when we shift our hope, and what we say is, we want something else to satisfy our souls. We're giving something else the power to dictate our lives in such a way that it will radically change us. That's what we're telling something else when we shift our hope from Jesus. Then what happens is, when those things don't deliver, and they're already uncertain, we all know, you hope somebody's going to change. You hope that person will call you back. You hope that job will come. You hope those medical reports will change. And we could hope and hope and hope and hope and hope and hope. But you know you're hoping in something uncertain. And then when they don't deliver, what ends up happening is your soul is now depleted, drained. And what's supposed to be in there, which is joy and peace, is now being filled with fear. Fear, because now what you hoped on is ruined, what you hoped in isn't coming true, and now you're afraid. Some of you have compromised so much of your life in relationships, in purity, in morality, because you hope that a person you're dating is going to change you. Some of you sacrificed family for a career because you hope that that career was going to change you. Some of you sacrificed so much because you thought, oh, if I get this money, if I get this, my hope is going to be that, and then everything's going to change. Everybody's going to like me. And two things happen. Maybe you got the money, but nobody likes you now, or you didn't get the money. You didn't get what you worked so hard for, what you hoped for. Would change everything. See, the issue is that we think that that hope is going to change us. That we're expecting something else to do what Jesus promises he will do. And when we shift our hope away from Jesus and into something else, we create fear. Second thing you need to know is this. Through hope delivers us from fear is this. Is that hope delivers us through good news. Delivers us good news to everyone. See, these angels came down and said, hey, I'm bringing you Jesus. And this hope comes through good news. Through good news to everyone. Everyone means everyone. Look here at this verse in Luke 2:10. Can we go to that verse in Luke 10? It says here, for look, the angel says, I proclaim to you good news of great joy that will be for all people, not some people, all people. Everyone will experience this. It doesn't matter how, listen, it doesn't matter where you come from, what you've done, what part of the world you live in, what political group you're with, no matter how bad you are in, and you may be spending years in jail for it, it doesn't matter. It's for all people, good, bad, Hitler, Mother Teresa. Everyone has an opportunity to receive this hope that's in Jesus Christ. It's crazy. In our church, in 2019, we're going to be very, very intentional about delivering hope to all people. We want you to be a part of it. The first thing I get to tell you about, and I'm excited, is our encore service. We have an encore service. You started seeing some promos about it, but at Lakeside, Sunday evenings at 6, starting January 13th, we're having a service for people who can't come to church on Sunday. Did you know that 1/3 of Central Floridians work on the weekends? Some of them work. Most of them work on Sunday mornings. And some of them are your friends, your neighbors, your loved ones who don't have the hope of Jesus Christ. And you keep talking to them, hey, come to church with me, come to church with me. But I can't because it's Sunday morning. Well, guess what? Some of you need to get to this place where you start really feeling the hope of Jesus. And that comes as you follow God and you begin to get a little bit uncomfortable. And you leave your comfortable chair at 9:30 to come and bring your friends to 6 o'clock. To get on a B team and serve at 6 o'clock is what we're doing. Afterwards, we're creating a nighttime coffee house experience right there at Lakeside. We've invested our money to make sure people hear the message of hope. And we want you to have conversations with them afterwards. We want you to be there with your friends. Our church is doing some things, guys. That's exciting. That's good news. The second thing we're doing, you've heard of our Dream Center. We're gonna partner up with this organization called Jobs Partnership, and what they need small group leaders. Small group leaders. And what you do as a small group leader, you're gonna meet some people that are under-resourced and don't have hope. They lost hope. And they're hoping that maybe if I get through this program, I could get a job and actually head down a good path. That's all they could hope for. They're hopeless. But then you as a small group leader, after you hear someone teach them some stuff, you just have discussion with them. And then by the grace of Jesus, I hope that you will find common ground with some of these people. And as you're talking about interviewing, as you're talking about how to deal with situations in the marketplace, as you're having conversation with them, you get to share them about the hope that you have. Because all of us have a backstory. All of us were in a point where we didn't have hope. All of us have shifted our hopes away from Jesus at time and felt the pain of that. And we get to point these people towards Jesus. And some of you, it's time. It's time for you to share the hope that's overflowing in you to someone else. So our church is doing some amazing things in 2019. And we want you to be a part of it. Because we're about delivering hope. That's what it means to be the church. Deliver hope. The other thing you need to know about hope is that hope comes from a Savior. Okay? Hope is in a Savior. Hope is in a Savior, and that Savior is Jesus Christ. Look what the angel says in Luke 2:11. He says this, "Today in the city of David, a Savior was born for you." For you, shepherd dude. For your friends, for your family, for those that you don't even like, for Rome that's oppressing you, for you, the Savior was born, who is the Messiah, the Lord. He was sent here to give you hope. And our privilege and our job as Christ followers is to show people how to make Jesus our Savior and put our hope in Him, and not our jobs, not our families, not anything else other than Jesus. Not our career, not the vacation, not the therapist, not anything else. Jesus is our hope. And Jesus, we trust, will lead us towards the right people to make us whole. Jesus, we trust, will lead us towards the right career where we could be distributors of hope. Jesus will lead us to the right counselors to help us when we're broken. Jesus will do His part, but we got to put our hope in Him and no one else, and allow Him to begin to change us. Because the hope that Jesus gives us is living. The hope that Jesus gives us is living. It's a living hope. It's not dormant, it doesn't rest, it doesn't take a break. It is constantly moving inside of you, growing inside of you, making you more like Jesus. Because if you're not becoming more like Jesus, let me tell you, newsflash, you know you're not becoming more like Jesus. But this living hope changes you. It overflows you with joy and peace and the fruit of the Spirit. There's a guy in the Bible named Peter. He was one of Jesus' best friends, and he writes this to some Christians who are dealing with a lot of pain, a lot of suffering. He says, "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. Because of His great mercy, He has given us a new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead." Now, he has given us a new birth. That means if there was a new birth, that must have been an old life. And some of you here, you've experienced this new birth. And you remember what the old life without hope is like. I mean, Paul writes about it in Ephesians 2:12. He says, hey, the people without Jesus, they don't have hope. And if you're in this room today and you don't know Jesus, you've been putting your hope on all other things. And you know right now, because your soul is letting you know, hey, I've been putting my hope in things that have disappointed. You're telling me that Jesus won't disappoint me? No, He won't. He won't. And He's going to give you a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ. I mean, the fact that you know Jesus resurrected from the dead tells me that we have a living hope, that we as Christians defeat death, that we as Christians have something waiting for us that's far greater than anything here on earth, that we as Christians, no matter what happens here, man, we get to look to heaven, we get to look to eternity, and what Jesus has in store for us will never perish, will never rust, will never go away. And then He says, hey, guess what? You get to experience that now. And you get to walk around every day, regardless of your pain, knowing that hope is coming, that hope is here, that hope is living, that life is coming, life that I've never experienced before. And why do I feel such joy, even in the midst of my crisis, and such peace and such clarity? I don't get it. It's because of the hope of Jesus. And it was funny, one of our staff members, she mentioned that when I shared this verse to her, she said, you know what, before I was a Christian, I would put my hope in all these other things, and I felt hope. I felt good because those things were working out for me. But then when I met Jesus, I realized all those things were false. And those things can't deliver like Jesus. Because nothing here on this earth can promise you eternal life. Nothing here on this earth can promise you that Jesus is going to be with you. couple years back, my father came to visit me about five years ago or so. And he wanted me to buy him this book, and he eventually gave it to me. And it's about this guy named Dietrich Bonhoeffer. If you're looking for a good read, this is it. And Dietrich Bonhoeffer lived during the Nazi regime, and he's known as a pastor, a martyr, a prophet, and a spy. And in this book, Eric Metaxas writes his biography, and he says that during the Nazi regime, Dietrich was a part of a conspiracy called Valkyrie. Remember Valkyrie, the movie with Tom Cruise? Well, that's where they get it from. He was a part of that conspiracy, and it failed. And eventually, Dietrich was thrown into a concentration camp and in prison with like four other guys just waiting to be executed. So 3 weeks before the Nazi regime was defeated, Hitler ordered his execution. Now, Dietrich had a lot of time to spend with a lot of the prison inmates and other people. And there was this doctor there, and he writes this. I just want to read this to you. He writes this about Dietrich Bonhoeffer. He says, "Through the half-open door in one room of the huts, I saw Pastor Bonhoeffer. Before taking off his prison garb, kneeling on the floor, praying fervently to his God. I was most deeply moved by the way this lovable man prayed, so devout and so certain that God heard his prayer. At the place of execution, he again said a short prayer, then climbed to the steps to the gallows, brave and composed. His death ensued after a few seconds. In the almost 50 years that I worked as a doctor, I have hardly ever seen a man die so entirely submissive to the will of God." Sometime before his execution, Dietrich was in London preaching, and he says this, and this is his sermon. Dietrich says, "Death is not bitter if we have not become bitter ourselves. Death is grace, the greatest gift of grace that God gives to people who believe in him." There's something unique about hope in Jesus Christ. Something that we have, if you're a follower of Jesus Christ, and no other person has, is a certainty that it keeps living inside of you. And I want to show you this. There's going to be a picture up here, and this is a time lapse of 5 years of this tree's life. So someone took a picture every day of this tree's life. And I want you to notice that the tree goes through all kinds of seasons of life. It goes through all kinds of different experiences, but it stays rooted in its source. And you, as a Christ follower, look, you're going to have times where it was really hard, where you're going to be pruned, where things don't make sense, and there's going to be time of silence with God, and you don't understand why, but you stay rooted, you stay obedient, you stay holding on to your Savior, you stay holding on to Jesus, and inside of you, there is a living hope, a hope that doesn't die, a hope that reminds you, look, as I'm dry, as I'm hurting, life will come again. My Jesus will continue to write a story. My Jesus loves me. My Jesus believes in me. And there is hope because of him, because it's living, it's thriving, and the story isn't over until he says it's over. Till he says it. And the story that your Heavenly Father wants you to know is that he's given you a living hope, and it's telling you what? As long as you're still breathing, there's hope. As long as you're still holding on to Jesus, he's going to do something great in you. So let's start the Christmas season with hope in Jesus. Let me pray. Heavenly Father, man, right now there are people in here who don't have hope in you. I just pray right now that they just look to you and say, "Jesus, forgive me for ignoring you. I want you to be my hope." I pray that that person just says that. "Forgive me for ignoring you. Forgive me for just rejecting you and putting my hope in other things. I want you to be my hope. I want your living hope inside of me, directing me, guiding me, growing me, filling me with joy and peace." God, I thank you for those that just prayed that prayer. And God, I ask for people in this room, Christ followers, who said, "You know what, God, I removed you. I started putting my hope in myself and other things. I'm sorry. Give me this hope so I could overflow and give it to somebody else. So I could overflow, and no matter what kind of pain, even in the midst of death, like Bonhoeffer, that I would walk knowing that you hear me, that you love me, that you believe in me, and you got something great in store for me, now and later. In the name of Jesus, I ask you to fill this church with hope. Give us with the passion. Give us passion. Give us direction to be conduits of hope to other people. In the name of Jesus.